Thank you, Chairpersons. Very good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My topic is adjuvant systemic treatment in high-risk endometrial cancer. It has been partially covered by Dr. Shupriyo, so my job is easier. So it's imperative to understand the biological differences between type 1 and type 2 endometrial cancer. Type 1 cancers are estrogen-dependent in contradistinction to type 2 cancers, which is estrogen-independent. And the prototype for type 1 cancer is endometrioid adenocarcinoma, and the prototype for type 2 cancers are serous and clear cell carcinomas. Moving to the factors determining the risk and outcome, the important prognostic factors are the grade of the tumor, the cell type, whether it's endometrioid or non-endometrioid, the depth of myo-invasion, lymphovascular space invasion, age less than 50, 50 to 70, or more than 70 years, and last but not the least, very important, tumor stage itself. So this is how the risk stratification is done in patients with endometrial cancer. They may be assigned low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. And intermediate risk can be further subclassified into low intermediate and high intermediate risk. So depending upon the presence of risk factors, it's very important to understand the patterns of failure in patients with endometrial cancer. In roughly 70 to 75% of patients with stage 1, stage 2 endometrial cancer, when recurrence happens, it's localized to the vagina. The other patterns of failure are lymphatic failure, nodes in the pelvis and the periaortic strip. They can be peritoneal or abdominal spread in patients with non-endometrioid histology, or they can be hematogenous spread. And there can be an overlap between these different modalities of spread. And these are the recurrence-free survival curves in patients with no risk factor versus patients with risk factor in endometrial cancer. Just a brief outline of the management of endometrial cancer, the early endometrial cancer, stage 1, stage 2. Fortunately, it constitutes 80% of all the patients we see. Surgery is the cornerstone of management in the form of total abdominal hysterectomy and bilateral salpingophorectomy, with or without lymphadenectomy, that is slightly debatable. And adjuvant radiation therapy should be offered in selected patients with high risk factors. Locally advanced, that is basically stage 3 and stage 4A endometrial cancer, it constitutes 15 to 20% of all patients we see. The treatment should be in the form of radical hysterectomy and adjuvant chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So moving on to the active chemotherapeutics in endometrial cancer, the agents with single agent efficacy are cisplatin, carboplatin, doxorubicin, epirubicin, paclitaxel, and docetaxel, with the response rate hovering between 20 to 40%. Quite predictably, when we combine the chemotherapeutic agents, the response rate increases to 40 to 60%. And traditionally, the common chemotherapy combinations are cisplatin-adriamycin, cisplatin-adriamycin cyclophosphamide, and more recently, paclitaxel and carboplatin, and docetaxel and cisplatin. This is a tabular representation of trials looking at adjuvant chemotherapy in patients with endometrial cancer. These trials have been done from Japan, from Europe, and United States. And most of the trials have failed to demonstrate any significant benefit in pelvic recurrence or overall survival improvement with the addition of adjuvant chemotherapy. With the exception of one trial published by Randall and Associates, where they demonstrated an overall survival benefit, an absolute benefit of 11% at 5 years, with the p-value being statistically significant. And most of the study designs in these trials were either pelvic radiotherapy versus chemotherapy, or pelvic radiotherapy versus a combination of pelvic radiotherapy and adjuvant chemotherapy. So I would be focusing on the GOG trial published by Randall and Associates in Journal of Clinical Oncology in 2006. 396 patients of advanced endometrial cancer with post-op residuum less than 2 cm, they were randomized into whole abdominal radiotherapy versus adjuvant chemotherapy. The whole abdominal radiotherapy dose was 30 grays in 20 fractions over 4 weeks. This is something what we routinely do not do in our clinical practice. And this was followed by a boost of 15 grays in 8 fractions over 1.5 weeks to the pelvis with or without the periaortic strip. The adjuvant chemotherapy regimen consisted of injection cisplatin 50 mg per meter square and doxorubicin 60 mg per meter square given every 3 weeks for a total of 8 cycles. The median follow-up was 74 months. And the authors demonstrated there was a 29% reduction in the hazard for disease progression favoring the chemotherapy arm, and a 32% reduction in the hazard for death, again favoring the chemotherapy arm, with the p-value being statistically significant. However, if we look at the percentage of patients completing the assigned treatment, only 63% could complete the assigned treatment in the chemo arm versus 84% in the whole abdominal radiotherapy arm. And the chemotherapy regimen was quite toxic, with the hematological toxicities grade 3 and grade 4 jumping from 14% to 88%. And the treatment-related death increased from 2% to 4%. So this trial is telling us the story that adjuvant chemotherapy increases the progression-free survival and the overall survival in patients with endometrial cancer. However, it's quite toxic, and we need a chemotherapy combination with better efficacy and lesser toxicity. So these are the Kaplan-Meier survival curves depicting the progression-free survival in patients receiving chemotherapy and patients receiving radiotherapy, and the Kaplan-Meier survival curves depicting overall survival in this two group of patients, with the p-value being statistically significant. This is the list of current trials, the PROTECT-3 trials, the GOG-249 and the GOG-258 trials, looking at the precise role of systemic chemotherapy in high-risk endometrial cancer patients. The preliminary results of the PROTECT-3 trial has been recently published in Lancet Oncology last year. 686 patients of stage 1 high-risk endometrial cancer, stage 2 and stage 3 endometrioid carcinoma, or stage 1 to 3 serous or clear cell carcinoma, they were randomized into pelvic radiotherapy or pelvic radiotherapy with concurrent and adjuvant chemotherapy. The pelvic radiotherapy schedule was 48.6 grays at the rate of 1.8 gray per fraction per day, and the same schedule in the chemoradiotherapy arm, and the concurrent cisplatin 50 mg per meter square was added in week 1 and week 4 of radiotherapy, and the adjuvant chemotherapy consisted of carboplatin and paclitaxel given every 3 weeks for a total of 4 cycles. The primary endpoints in the study were overall survival and failure-free survival, and the secondary endpoints were treatment-related toxicity, health-related quality of life, pelvic and distant relapse. The median follow-up was just shy of 4 years, and the authors reported in the experimental arm, the quality of life was significantly worse at completion of RT and 6 months thereafter, but improved with time at 1 and 2 years. There was a significantly increased grade 2 plus and grade 3 plus acute adverse events, mostly hematological, in the experimental arm, and it's important to note that 1 out of every 4 patients reported severe tingling and numbness, perhaps because of paclitaxel as well as cisplatin. And the final results of this trial has been presented at the recently concluded ASCO 2017 meeting. The median follow-up had increased up to 5 years. And the 5-year overall survival were 76.7% versus 81.8% in patients undergoing radiotherapy versus chemoradiotherapy, with the hazard ratio being 0.79 and the p-value being statistically non-significant. The 5-year failure-free survivals were 68.9% versus 75.5%, with the hazard ratio being 0.77 and the p-value being again statistically non-significant. However, when they did the subset analysis, they identified a group, that is patients with stage 3 endometrial cancer, who fared much worse compared to patients with stage 1 and stage 2 endometrial cancer. And this is the subset which had the greatest benefit with the addition of concurrent and adjuvant chemotherapy. So the conclusion was, compared with RT alone, adjuvant chemotherapy given during and after pelvic RT did not significantly improve the 5-year failure-free survival and overall survival. However, in patients with stage 3 endometrial cancer, the failure-free survival was significantly improved by chemo RT by 11% at 5 years. Switching gears and moving to the GOG-249 study, 601 patients with of stage 1 high risk or stage 2 endometrioid carcinoma or stage 1 2 serous and clear cell carcinoma with peritoneal cytology negative, they were randomized to pelvic RT or vaginal cuff brachytherapy and adjuvant chemotherapy. The pelvic RT schedule was 44 grays in 25 fractions over 5 weeks, and the vaginal cuff brachytherapy was followed by 3 cycles of adjuvant carboplatin and paclitaxel. The primary endpoint was relapse-free survival, and the secondary endpoints were overall survival, incidence of vaginal, pelvic, and extrapelvic recurrence. At a median follow-up of 2 years, there was no significant difference in overall survival and relapse-free survival in the study arms, Quite predictably, the acute adverse effects were more frequent and severe in the experimental arm. And these are the Kaplan-Meier survival curves depicting recurrence-free survival in the two study arms. And we can appreciate that the two curves are quite superimposable. And if we focus our attention to the patterns of failure, the vaginal failure rates were 2% versus 1%, pelvic failures 1% versus 6%, paraotic failures 1% each, and distant failures 11% versus 8% in the radiotherapy versus vaginal curve brachy and adjuvant chemotherapy arm, respectively. The last study I want to discuss, the GOG258 study, 813 patients with advanced endometrioid, CDERS, clear cell, or undifferentiated carcinoma, optimally debulked to less than 2 cm. They were randomized to tumor volume-directed radiotherapy with concurrent and adjuvant chemotherapy. The concurrent and adjuvant chemotherapy regimen was the same regimen which was used in the experimental arm in the POTIC-3 trial, and the experimental arm was the adjuvant chemotherapy. Adjuvant chemotherapy consisted of 6 cycles of carboplatin and paclitaxel given every 3 weeks. The primary endpoint was relapse-free survival. The secondary endpoints were treatment-related toxicities, health-related quality of life, and overall survival. The median follow-up was just shy of 4 years, and the authors concluded that the combined modality treatment did not significantly improve the relapse-free survival compared with chemotherapy alone, with the hazard ratio being 0.9, and the 95% confidence interval of the hazard ratio crossing 1. The estimates for 5-year overall survival were 70% and 73% respectively in the two study arms. Coming to the toxicity profile, grade 3-4 acute morbidities, there was no significant difference in chemo-RT versus chemotherapy alone group, the incidence rates being 58% versus 63% overall. Again, if we carefully look at the patterns of failure, the incidence of failures were 3% versus 7% in the vagina, favoring the chemo-RT arm, and the incidence of failures, the nodal failures in the pelvis and the paraotic strip were 10% versus 21%, again favoring the chemo-RT arm. On the flip side, there was a numerical increase in distant recurrence in chemo-RT arm, 28% versus 21%. So this trial is telling the story that in spite of an absence of significant benefit in overall survival and progression-free survival, addition of tumor volume-directed radiotherapy significantly decreases the vaginal and the nodal recurrence. So coming to the NCCN 2017 guidelines to look where chemotherapy fits in the guidelines. In patients with stage 1 endometrial cancer with myo-invasion more than 50% and grade 3, the recommendation is external beam RT plus minus vaginal brachytherapy plus minus systemic therapy. In patients with stage 2 endometrial cancer, grade 3, the same recommendation, external beam RT plus minus vaginal brachytherapy plus minus systemic therapy. And they are category 2 conditions. And NCCN strongly recommends the use of systemic chemotherapy with or without external beam RT and vaginal brachytherapy in advanced, that is stage 3, stage 4A, endometrioid, CDERS, and clear cell carcinomas. Coming to the AIMS adjuvant chemotherapy policy, we give systemic chemotherapy in patients with stage 3 endometrial cancer in all stages with CDERS and clear cell carcinoma. The regimen what we use is injection paclitaxel and carboplatin, paclitaxel 175 mg per meter square IV day 1, and carboplatin target AOC5 IV day 2. They also can be given on the same day because of logistic reasons. They're given every 3 weeks for a total of 6 cycles. Coming to the sequence, the ideal sequence is surgery followed by 6 cycles of chemotherapy followed by pelvic external beam RT followed by brachytherapy, or it can be given like surgery followed by sandwich chemotherapy, 3 cycles of chemo, RT, and then 3 more cycles of chemo. So to conclude, multimodality management is the cornerstone of treatment for high-risk early and advanced endometrial cancer. Adjuvant chemotherapy is strongly recommended in optimally debulked advanced endometrial cancer. The role of systemic chemotherapy, however, is unclear in high-risk early endometrial cancer. A combination of paclitaxel and carboplatin has emerged as the most acceptable regimen in community practice due to good efficacy and manageable toxicity profile. The optimal integration and sequencing of radiotherapy with concurrent and adjuvant chemotherapy needs to be defined and refined in near future. With this, I'd like to conclude and thank you very much for your kind attention.